We have separated cash rails and commodities rails and securities transaction rails. We have markets that are separated by jurisdictions globally. Blockchain makes it possible for all of these rails to come together and for us to have unified markets, which makes them much more accessible.
My name is Nadine Chakar. I'm the global head of DTCC Digital Assets.
I'm Dan Doney, and I am the managing director, CTO of DTCC Digital Assets, and formerly the founder of Securency.
We think the potential is huge. I mean, we've been at this game now for about 10 years. There's been a lack of a unifying organization, a center of gravity, if you will, to bring the industry all together. And that's where DTCC comes in to this process. So we are looking at a multifaceted approach to try to bring the industry together. One, by rolling up the products that Dan and his team are building. So that is really looking at the entire life cycle of tokenization. So it's really the entire life cycle where Dan and the team have done some amazing things. And he always talks about it's compliance first, which is really important in our industry and also as part of DTCC, right? We look after the safety and soundness of the markets, and we intend to do that as we move forward with digital infrastructure. The second component is really creating environments where we can finally move away from these individual one-offs, proof of concepts, and start to move into production. And then the third component is working, again, with the industry and the fintech providers out there to build what's called a tier one setup, which is resilient. But the whole idea is to really do for digital assets what we do for traditional assets and have a resilient, scalable, and interoperable environment. So that is what we're striving to do. We want to be the digital financial markets of the future, and that is the strategy that we're pushing forward on.
The impact is broad, but I'm going to highlight three specific cases that we think are really the next few years will be dominated by these cases. The first is private markets. So private markets in general are very disjointed. Many private market transactions occur really managed by spreadsheets in most cases, and in some cases by systems that are disconnected and dissimilar. This makes liquidity in private markets very difficult, and transactions that might involve even lending or borrowing against assets are virtually impossible. On blockchain rails, that really changes everything, where the full life cycle of a private market asset can really be managed efficiently, and that will open things and really blend private markets with public markets. The second case I think is important is product structuring. There's a technology and a relatively new approach in blockchain, which is the ability to take a token and embed into the token a wallet. So the concept of an asset which can own other assets or positions. Well, that's what product structuring is really all about, is taking, for example, a long position and hedging, creating a new financial instrument. Those can be created very quickly in this new model. It also includes direct indexing. So you can take and put a wrapper around an indexing strategy and allow folks, either individually or as small groups, to effectively create their own funds. There are tax advantages. It's a more efficient wrapper as you take those strategies. And you'll see a lot of innovation in products thanks to this power of blockchain. The third, and maybe the most consequential here in the short run, is the use and automation of collateral and collateral management processes. Most transactions are actually repo transactions, securities lending transactions, margin transactions. Actually, those dominate the market volume on a daily basis. And if you can automate the entire collateral management flow and then automate these individual processes, what you free up is instant settlement of these transactions for financial institutions. And the impact of that is a massive release of value that's locked in their balance sheets, even intraday. And that can have a major impact on the bank's efficiency and performance, on the order of millions of dollars a day. There's a substantial driver there. And once you open those markets to tokenization and automation, everything else follows.
So as one famous Bostonian once said, the institutions are coming, the institutions are coming, right? And we're starting to see progress where more certainty in the market is helping institutional adoption, such as the approvals of FIT21, other instruments, both ETH and Bitcoin, spot ETFs. Those have been super helpful in pushing the movement forward. It just shows you there's pinned up demand. It is pushing through. There's a couple of things that are a little bit different about this. This is the first time in our history where we've seen actually retail lead and institutional follow, but the certainty that we're getting right now from the regulatory and the legal framework is helpful, and we'll continue hopefully to see that progress. Also, the use cases that Dan talked about, they have a common denominator here is they bring more efficiency into the process, right? We know how to manage collateral. We know how to do all these things. A firm like DTCC or most middle and back offices have done historically is really the bridge between the inefficiencies of the markets, the front and the back office. This technology, blockchain accentuated by tokenization, helps free up these processes, create more efficiencies, both on the cost as well as on the revenue side, and also create capital efficiencies. All those are primed for any institutional provider, whether you're an investor or a provider of services. They've got to be attractive to look at. Now, the secret, though, is you can't do the same old thing with new technology, right? This is also an invitation and opportunity to reimagine and revisit your operating models, your processes. And if you do that, we will hopefully see adoption, we will see volume, and then these efficiencies will be as simple as that as they pop up in their environment.
The growth of these markets really underscores what I think everyone is seeing, that by 2030, they're anticipating on the order of $15 trillion worth of assets on blockchain rails, and far more transactions per day based on that assets under management under blockchain. While having a financial market infrastructure that can handle those assets, that is, that meets the highest regulatory standards of a SIFMU, of a systemically important financial market utility, that's a challenge. So things like being able to handle the scale of US or even global markets. Blockchain in its current form, blockchain implementations, can't handle that scale. We know that in that time frame, quantum computing is likely to be a threat, and we'll need post-quantum technologies in that time frame. Another big shortcoming of blockchain markets as they stand today is a lack of data standards. So there are standardized interfaces, ERC-20 being a great example of something that's transformed the way that a simple wallet that you can download can interact with any token that's issued. But the problem is there's no standardization of the data. So if you were to attempt to find a token, let's say you're interested in South American mining interests. There are a bunch of tokens out there. You can't find them. You don't know what they mean, what they represent. So if you have this on your balance sheet and you're trying to understand your portfolio and risks, there is no standardized data. So we're introducing a mechanism for data standardization that allows you to take ISDA standards and other mechanisms so that you can look at blockchain-based assets, you can look at wallets, and understand what they mean and perform traditional risk management and portfolio management solutions. This will open up financial markets to the kinds of financial modeling that large institutions expect.
In addition to everything that Dan said, those are the big problems that need to be solved. There are more pressing, immediate problem. And the one that we find the most is people don't know where to start. There is still an overwhelming, I don't know if it's fear or intimidation about the technology, despite the fact it's been around for quite a bit of time. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done around education. You also have a lot of financial institutions that have sunk billions in their technology. So telling them to throw it all away for new digital rails, that's a hard pill to swallow as well. So a lot of the work that Dan and the team have done has been to create these infrastructures that actually can bring the old and the new together. What we're doing at DTCC is also providing safe environments where they can go in and experiment and understand how that impacts their operating models, their business models, and be able with high confidence go to their management teams or their boards and try to put the case of why they should be looking at digital. We know digital is not the cure to the common cold. Not everything's going to be tokenized, but whatever can be tokenized should be tokenized. And we would like to be part of that support infrastructure to allow them to better understand what it is, understand the financials, understand the risks, and hopefully make educated decisions as they move forward. So there's the short term that we're dealing with and a lot of the medium to longer term challenges that Dan and the team are trying to resolve.
Nadine's point is a good one, that interoperability, this ability to bridge between legacy systems and the new blockchain rails is a critical enabler. It's you shouldn't have to make a choice to go to the digital world and then never come back or to stay where you are. And a big part of that is, again, making these technologies accessible and interoperable. So they have to meet the accounting risk management strategies of institutions. They have to be easy. If I have to teach my mother how to use a wallet in order to invest, it's just not going to happen practically and easily. So a lot of the technologies that we're building out, that are being built across the industry, are designed to simplify, make it easy for folks to enter. And what you see in terms of interoperability is there's a proliferation of ledgers. What we expect is innovation will continue in ledger technologies for indefinitely. In order to be able to meet the scale requirements that we just mentioned, you'll see that ledger technologies, there will be many. This is why Chainlink's role is so very important, is we expect that there'll be many ledgers, and there's a need to move value between the ledgers, and especially the need to move data between ledgers. So ultimately, to get to true consensus, and remember, DTCC is the consensus model for US markets. We just happen to do it in now T plus one. Ultimately, to do it in T plus zero, that means we need to get to common meaning. When transactions settle, we all have to know that they mean the same thing. And if our target is near instantaneous settlement, then data has to agree across all of these ledgers. And this is why our partnership with Chainlink is so very important, because this allows us to write data once and have it proliferate across all of the networks, to move value freely between whatever the best ledger technology is of the day, so that we can meet the high volume requirements that are coming, and we continue to innovate as ledger technologies grow. I see markets becoming unified. So we have separated public and private markets. We have separated debt and equity instruments. We have separated cash rails and commodities rails and securities transaction rails. We have markets that are separated by jurisdictions globally. Blockchain makes it possible for all of these rails to come together and for us to have unified markets, which makes them much more accessible. As Nadine mentioned, individuals don't get easy access globally to investment opportunities. And so by bringing all of these marketplaces together, making transactions extremely efficient, we're able to get to markets that are more fair and more open in the future.
I dream of a world that is totally open, efficient, accessible, democratized. And that's what I love about this technology. It offers goodness across the board, whether it's on the cost side, the capital efficiency side, on the revenue side. But it also makes a lot of these sophisticated, high-value investments accessible to a lot of people, right? Which is something we don't have that luxury. Dan originally talked about private markets being a good use case. Today, the minimums to enter these markets is pretty high. They're highly expensive to manage and run. So all these technologies allow us to truly democratize access to the best investment minds that are out there and hopefully achieve the financial equity going through that. But it also allows us to, as an industry, we've been, if you will, the bridge in trying to eliminate inefficiencies in the market. I think the technology right now will help us achieve that. And lastly, I think the technology becomes the trusted party, which also doesn't mean that, and that's really important, it doesn't mean that anybody disappears from the ecosystem. I think our roles change, whatever role you play. And I do believe there is room for everybody. There's rooms for the fintechs. There are rooms for intermediaries, as well as the banking institutions. It's just, I think our roles will change. And at the end of the day, I think the end consumer is the winner here. So everything that we aspire to, make sure that it's accessible, it's safe, it's scalable, it's reliable. I think these digital rails allow us to do that, especially if we can also integrate it with whatever doesn't tokenize and remains on legacy organization, being able to give that client, the client, an amazing experience at the end of it. That's where I think our markets will be heading. So they'll be safe, they'll be secure, they'll be compliant, scalable, resilient, and accessible to all.